A while ago, someone asked me if I knew of any clock radios with stereophonic audio playback capability that also had a headphone jack. Here's one right now. This is the General Electric model number 7-4945A clock radio. It is my carefully considered opinion that throughout the 1970s, 1980s, even up into the early to mid-1990s, that General Electric and later Thomson Consumer Electronics produced some of the best clock radios that money could buy, no matter whether you selected a basic model or something much fancier like this particular unit. Let's go ahead and see what this unit offers in the way of features. We'll start with what I think is perhaps the most awesome feature of all, and that is the presence of a vacuum fluorescent display. There's really only one bad thing that I could ever say about vacuum fluorescent displays, and that's their unfortunate tendency to wear themselves out over time. But as we'll soon see, in fact, as you might be able to see right now, this particular radio, which is in remarkable condition for its age, seems to have a very low hours vacuum fluorescent display. It also has a variable brightness display, although you only get to choose between low brightness, which you see right now, and high brightness, which really drives home the fact that, once again, this is a very low hours display. And while you can see that there are provisions for this display to support 24-hour timekeeping, and who knows, perhaps a 24-hour capable version of this particular clock radio does exist, but this model is confined to 12-hour timekeeping only. Of course, a person could probably venture inside the circuitry and see if the needed change could be made, as the timekeeping chip almost certainly has the capability to display and maintain a record of 24-hour time. So what else do you get beyond the display? Well, obviously you get stereo audio playback capability. We have the left speaker here, the right speaker there, and despite their close proximity to one another, there actually is a discernible stereo effect from this particular clock radio. And then you have the capability to plug in a stereo headset. Now, lots of companies have manufactured FM stereo playback capable clock radios over the years, though as far as I know, no one's ever made one that supported AM stereo as well. But when you start to look for a headphone connection in a stereo clock radio, well, I think I'm correct in saying that your options dwindle considerably. You get the digital clock display, as previously indicated, an FM stereo indicator, battery backup capability, which we'll take a look at in just a moment, two wake times, I'll have more to say about that in just a bit, and of course an analog tuning dial featuring the FM and AM bands. And as you can see from the larger type size employed in the identification of the FM band, you can see that's clearly where the focus was, but I think I'm correct in telling you that this unit is still a pretty competent performer on AM, even if you only get monophonic audio playback. We'll be looking into that a little bit later. Let's go ahead and take a look at some of the controls that are present on the top panel. We'll lean it over here so you can see. The first set of controls has to do with the clock, as do most of the buttons on the top of this unit. You get a time set button that you have to press in order to tell this unit that you wish to change how the clock is currently set. This is a nice touch compared to some other clock radios, where if you're fumbling around in the morning trying to shut the thing off, and the clock buttons don't have any kind of a lockout on them, well, you can inadvertently end up changing the time. And, as an added bonus, you also get not only controls for adjusting the time in fast and slow motion forwards, but fast and slow motion in reverse as well. Although on this particular example, it seems that the slow reverse button is a little bit touchy and sometimes behaves as though it were operating in the way that the fast button would operate. It's probably dirty controls of some kind. Another very nice feature that you get, at least when the display is in its low brightness mode, if you press the time set button, you'll know right away because the display brightens instantly. A very handy feature. Maybe not, but it still shows that there was some thought put into the design of this unit. Further examples of thought put into the design of this unit, you get two alarms, and unlike a lot of clock radios that are equipped with dual alarm capability, each person can actually choose to wake to alarm or music. It's not like a lot of clock radios where you have to choose if you want to wake to either alarm or music. you can't have your own choice if you're using both alarms. One of them is confined to the alarm, and one of them is confined to music. It's kind of a ham-fisted explanation, but hopefully it drives home the point. Of course, you get a snooze button, and as per usual, General Electric love to spell it without the Z. I have no idea why. It's not very impressive compared to the way that some manufacturers chose to identify the snooze button. I really like the fact that Sony used to call it the Dream Bar on their Dream machines, even though, obviously, when the alarm goes off, it's going to shatter your dreams. And then, of course, there is a sleep timer button. If you'd like to listen to the radio while you fade off to sleep, this model certainly has you covered. Now, with some clock radios, you only get a 59-minute countdown. With others, you can actually manually specify up to an hour and 59 minutes worth of sleep time. I'm not sure which one this unit does, but we'll try to find out here. And it would appear that all you get is just up to 1 hour's worth of sleep time on this particular model. So that particular feature might be a little lacking, but realistically, who listens to the radio for almost 2 hours before they go to sleep? I'm sure someone in the comments is going to tell me that they do. And then, of course, we have the buttons that govern the operation of the radio. The off button, the on button, which as you can see has a nice little tactile cue. A very welcome feature if you're looking to use this unit in the dark, as I suspect a lot of people certainly are likely to do. And then you have a switch that allows you to choose the method of radio reception and which band you would like to receive. You can specify automatic FM stereo operation, which turns on the stereo decoder circuitry whenever an analog FM stereo broadcast is detected. You can choose regular FM, which forces the unit to monophonic reception. Sometimes that's desirable if the station you want to receive has a noisy FM subcarrier. And then you have what is unfortunately probably an afterthought in the form of the AM band selection as well. Since there's so much computer-generated noise and interference down here, we'll actually listen to this unit a little bit later. I'll take it outside to the garage, where I can receive a lot more radio stations than I can here in the basement. And then finally, rounding out the unit's set of controls, on this side we have the radio tuner. We'll zoom in on these so you can see them a little bit better. We have a volume control, and then here is another thing that shows willing and a desire by General Electric's engineers to have produced a high-fidelity design, at least as much as small speakers in a plastic cabinet would have allowed them to do. This is a tone control. It is a combination treble and bass control. When you turn it one way, you boost the bass up and you cut the treble, or more realistically, you boost the mid-bass, because these small speaker drivers, they can't relay a lot of bass sound without extreme distortion, so they just don't even try. You turn it the other way, you cut the bass, and you boost the treble. And it has to be said that even with the control turned up all the way towards the treble direction of its travel, you still don't get a lot of treble with this unit. I would not call its audio particularly crisp, even at the best of times. And then on the back of the unit, we have information about where it was manufactured. I believe that the letter suffix on these clock radios indicates a different manufacturing run. You'll notice that this unit was manufactured in Malaysia, which is a departure from the usual Singapore, where General Electric did a lot of their electronics manufacturing. I would have loved to have seen that factory back in the day. It must have been absolutely incredible. Of course, it tells us all about the wood grain finish on polystyrene. And then here is the backup battery compartment. There was a crusty battery in here, like there almost always is. These things are worse than smoke detectors when it comes to people remembering to change them out, because it's easy to forget, let's face it. But it wasn't damaged, and it appears that the compartment is enclosed enough that a leaky battery would be limited in the amount of havoc that it could wreak on this poor clock radio's unsuspecting internals. Unfortunately, that did not happen in this case. So there's a look at the unit itself. Let's go ahead and do a band scan and some listening tests, just to get a feel for how this thing sounds and how well it performs on each radio band.
1970, Candy Stanton hit the top five of the R&B charts with the tune. Sometimes it's hard. 1982, Motorhead, featuring Wendy O. Williams of the Plasmatics. Surprisingly, some men recorded it as well, like David Allan Coe, Elton John, and who can forget from the movie The Blues Brothers.
Sometimes it's hard to be a woman.
The song was spoofed on Sesame Street, Stand By Your Can, performed by Hammy Swinette, urging people to put their trash in a trash can.
Sometimes it's hard to be a trash can.
There's even a rap version. Compliments of LL Cool J. Sarah Evans, Dolly Parton, Loretta Lynn, Martina McBride, and many others performed the song. But only one version stood the test of time and is no doubt the definitive version. From 1968, Tammy Wynette.
Sometimes. Did you hurt like me, that's slamming door? Did you leave for good or just get bored? Why have you left the one you left me for?
Was heard, a fringe of men with a trembling word, ran loud and clear. What am I doing here? Please, mister.
Somebody's gonna hurt someone before the night is through.
Catch up on my blue jeans, I just burned my hand. Lord, it's hard to be a bachelor man. I got girls that can cook, I got girls that can clean, I got girls.
When we look at each other now, there's no love in our eyes. And when we talk to each other now.
Well, let it henceforth be known that if you can twitch your ears, you are a minority. Not many can do that. And of those who can, only a third can twitch one ear at a time. No one asks. Nobody cares. I told you anyway.
About the way they have to live here in this country. Harping on the wars we fight. Griping about the way things ought to be. I don't mind them swearing.
Don't look so sad. I know it's
I ain't never seen nobody like you. No, never, ever seen nobody like you. You call me up, you say.
Tonight, we want to take your calls, your stories, and mix them together with the best songs. The songs that celebrate all that is good and right with summertime. With cold watermelon and hot summer days. With kids playing in little kiddie pools, splashing and laughing and having so much fun. We are here to celebrate the joys of summertime with you.
1,000 firefighters now on the front lines in Utah. 1,500 people near the resort town of Bryan Head forced out of their homes. A heat wave affecting most of the west and southwest, making things worse. Major fires are burning in 8 states. One erupted today in Santa Clarita, north of Los Angeles.
Kratz is an analyst with Auto Trader.
There are not very many airbag makers. So a lot of these recalled vehicles have not been fixed. The airbags don't exist for them to be fixed yet.
It's expected that a Chinese company, Key Safety Systems, will buy Takata, but it's unclear yet if they will assume Takata's liability. Maggie Penman, NPR News.
And now for a quick band scan on both AM and FM alike.
Louis, Missouri.
I'm tired of the way they think.
New York.
I still make it back.
Now, over to AM, where unfortunately it seems that conditions just aren't quite what they ought to be tonight for some really good long-distance reception. On a good night, I can pull in Nashville's 650 WSM. On a really good night, I can even pull in Toronto's AM 740, but neither one of those seems to be doing much tonight. And I'm just about out of memory card here.
And the coolest thing about him, I met him because of Michael Brown, and just listening to his story.
What? 6 years.
Yeah.
I mean, on and off with an interlude.
So Jimmy Too Tall and Johnny Fishlips and whoever else.
That might be 650 right there. And now a test of the alarm buzzer. Whose loudness is, rather impressively, actually governed by the volume control. Now, initially, I wasn't going to focus much on how well the battery memory retention in this particular unit happened to work, but it just so happens that because I am a professional lazy butt who is again operating on a closed course, and I didn't have any time sources in the garage that I could use, there are no working clocks out there, I did, in fact, stick a brand new 9-volt battery into this thing just so I wouldn't have to reset the clock. And while I can hardly ding this thing any number of points for not keeping tremendously accurate time when the battery backup was called into play, unfortunately it seems to have lost about 30 seconds over the course of maybe 5 minutes that it took me to get out to the garage, get everything set up, and to subsequently bring this thing back in after I was done recording. So, again, my opinion still stands with this particular unit and any other clock radio that I've worked with so far that the battery backup functionality is really more of a suggestion than anything else. I've had the best results, if you can believe it, by plugging these things into a conventional uninterruptible power supply. Doesn't even have to be anything fancy. Doesn't even seem like it's got to be anything with a true sine wave output, although you run the risk of overheating a power transformer in one of these things. I've never had it happen. And amazingly, the 60 Hz time base of the UPS, wherever it gets that reference from when it's running on battery after the mains supplied power has gone away, it's remarkably accurate. I've had my alarm clock up in my bedroom plugged into a battery backup for a number of years, and it's worked far better than having a 9-volt battery in it ever did. And of course, the 9-volt batteries in these things, they never seem to last very long. But one thing I do happen to be curious about before we go ahead and wrap this video up, I'd like to see if the alarm on this unit actually sounds in the absence of electrical power. Now, the radio alarm probably wouldn't, but I'd be willing to bet that the buzzer might. Some of these units have a sure alarm or safe alarm feature. So we'll set the alarm, to a couple minutes in the future. We'll arm the alarm. It's now 10:31. And then we'll trace back the power cord. You can all look at my big gut. We'll unplug this thing and just see if the alarm actually happens to go off when the unit has a backup battery in place. It might take a little bit. This is highly exciting stuff that you're looking at right here. Of course, I'd probably better turn the volume control up a little bit. We'll just have to wait it out. I'm thinking that it probably should have tripped by now. So I'm leaning towards it not having any sort of a sure alarm or a similar backup feature for the alarm buzzer. And that would really beat a 9-volt battery to death very quickly. I'll give it maybe 30 more seconds here. And then we'll plug it back in and see if it remembers that it had had an alarm that was scheduled to go off. Let's go ahead and plug it back in here. Well, I'll give it credit for that. At least the alarm went off when I restored power to it. So it's not like you'd be hugely late unless, of course, the power was off for hours and hours, and then there's probably no point in going to work anyway. And finally, if you happen to be looking for something with a bit more contemporary visual styling while still maintaining the capability of using stereo headphones and receiving FM programming in stereo, General Electric has you covered there too, with the model number 7-4664A. This unit is black in color, and it's also got you covered, if nothing else will do, but you must have an E on your snooze button. So thank you as always for watching, and certainly do feel free to leave a comment if you happen to have one.
And that concludes our program for tonight.
Tune in again next week for more good times and great music.
I'm so glad we had this time together.
Leave us exit station left.
Y'all come back now here.
Kiss me goodnight.
We now return control of the airwaves.
Goodnight.